and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. There's a lot in that last verse. So let's try to unpack the last verse. For certain people have crept in unnoticed. Notice the last part. They deny our Master and Lord Jesus Christ. All right, here's what ought to be obvious. Vocally, they are not denying Christ. Otherwise, surely we would notice it. Right? I mean, somebody came to church and they were vocal or in conversations, whether in Bible study in Sunday school or after church or just in general, they say, well, you know, I just really don't believe Jesus is the Son of the living God. I think you would notice then. So therefore, if they crept in unnoticed, and then it says they deny our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ, obviously, they are doing this in a covert fashion, and obviously, Jude is not saying that they stand up and say, I don't believe Jesus is the Son of God. It is by what they teach, by what they believe, that they are not believing in our Jesus. They have somehow or another perverted our Jesus. Still use the same name. Still use the same words. But they somehow or another give it a different meaning, the content of the gospel. Notice, for certain people have crept in unnoticed. Long ago they were designated for this condemnation, ungodly people, and here it is. They pervert the grace of our God into sensuality. What does that mean? They pervert, this is the way that the old commentaries, old preachers would have said it. They pervert the grace of our God by saying that the grace of God is a license to sin. Particularly, sensuality's word here, particularly sexual. In other words, that old thing, y'all remember from the 60s and the 70s, early 70s, Sammy Davis Jr., the devil made you do it. Or, I've been forgiven. However I'm living now, I've been forgiven. Now we understand that we all sin. Sinless, within. And they're leading people within the church astray. Therefore, the church must stand against them and contend for the faith. When does the gospel stop being the gospel? What is the gospel? A couple of stories. And I'm not trying to throw stones. I'm giving illustrations from folks that I run into, rub elbows with every day, just like you. New church start. It's going fantastic. Now the style is different than probably most of us would care for, but that's not the point. I run into a young lady, and I'm talking and sharing with her, trying to turn her toward Christ Jesus. Her life is a mess. She's been married, divorced, now living after the divorce, living with man number three. Something like that. I've been talking with her for a while. Haven't been successful in getting her into church. Then I find out that she's going to this new church start, and I'm praising God for that. Until I run into her and I'm talking. of the gospel was confronting two people living in the midst of sexual sin. And evidently with no reference to repentance or what that means or an explanation of what that means, never challenged the situation they were in as sin, leads two sinners in a prayer followed by baptism when there has been no change, no teaching. And by the way, she knows it's wrong. I've already talked to her about it. But that's irregardless. We'll say she doesn't know. So there's no teaching involved in this. There's no repentance involved in this. There's nobody even asking her to change. Is that still the gospel? Or has someone crept in unnoticed, ungodly, who lead others into sensuality or to leave them stuck there? That's one story. But in case you believe I'm picking on New Church Starts, I will tell you another. A good friend of mine, been the pastor of Country Church now for 3-4 years. Bible school is coming up, Kelly. And there's a young lady that's come to church there, has been there the whole time coming to church, who is not married, has a couple of kids by a couple of different folks, and is currently living with someone else. She's come to church there. As far as I know, maybe she's a member. I don't know. But she's come to church. Don't we want our church to deal with those kinds of people? To tell them the truth of the gospel? Certainly do. Bible school is coming up. He doesn't notice anything till the first night of Bible school as he's walking around and he finds this young lady in one of the classes teaching the children. She's currently living with an individual. He waits till the night is over. He prays through it. He thinks about it. He makes some mistakes. I'll garner that, but which ones of us don't? He should have taken somebody with him. He didn't. He goes to her home the next day, and he talks with her about her living arrangements. And he says to her, as long as you are living like a married woman with a man that is not your husband, I want you to continue to come to church, but you cannot hold a teaching, a Bible teaching position of any kind in our church. As soon as they start, he realizes what it's about, and he kind of stops them, and he lays out exactly what happened and what he did, right, wrong, or what he did, how he went to her, how he talked to her, and told her he wanted to continue to come to church, but she couldn't run a Bible teaching position in the church when she was living with a man who was not lawfully her husband. There was a problem. Half the deacons in that meeting were kin to her. And before everything was over, in God's church? Absolutely we do. Because we want to get them saved. And we want to teach them how to change. It was a Sunday morning. He said, "What must I do to be saved?" And I said, "You must believe on Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. You must repent of your sins. That means I expect you to move out of the house tonight. I don't know where you're going to go, but you're not going to stay there."